So I'm going to do something entirely different. I'm going to speculate a lot. So it's about, you know, about vote advice applications. These are the systems that citizens can use to be informed about policy positions of political parties. And so Alex asked me to do something about that, but we don't know a lot about the effects and the role of voting advice applications in the political campaign. We do know quite a bit about the effects on voters, but the effects on parties, on the media, on the campaign itself, it's very unclear. Okay, what are voting advice applications? These are, you all know about this, especially in many countries they're extremely popular. These are web applications that are online during the campaign that calculate the distance between a voter and a party. And the distance is calculated based on the number of statements. So voters get statements, 30, 20, 36, 50 statements in some voting advice applications. And party elites, or based on party elites' answers, or based on party manifestos, there is the party position, and basically the system just calculates the distance. What is typical for VAAs is that they only contain policy positions. It's not about leadership. Do you need a mic?
Yeah.
No.
Maybe for the streaming.
Yeah?
Or maybe just go.
Okay. Okay. Is this better? So it's about policy positions. Typical about VAAs is also that they are sponsored by the mass media. So it's the mass media who pays for setting up the systems. And also, and this applies, this implies our community, most voting advice applications are made by political scientists. I think almost all voting advice applications across Europe are made by political scientists. And there is even a struggle. There are two schools of voting advice applications. There is and we use the Dutch words kieswijzer system and then the kieskompas system, and they have slightly different ways of calculating distances. The one works with dimensions, the other system does not work with dimensions. And this is how the output looks. This is the last Belgian one. Well, it's in Dutch. Welke partijen passen het beste bij u? And what a voter gets is just a list of parties with it in a D, and this is the you have almost 80% overlap, so the position of the voter is almost 80% the same than that first party, N-VA, which is in this case the Flemish Nationalist Party, who is now the biggest party in Flanders. So voters get a list of parties, and they get the implicit advice to vote for the first party, to vote for the party that is closest to their policy position. This is what a vote advice application is. What is the relevance? Well, the relevance is that there are a lot of systems around. We counted, well, not we counted, but some people counted, there are almost 40 different systems at the latest election, and in some countries they're extremely popular, and there is a boom of users. In some countries, like in Finland and in Belgium, voting advice applications are launched in big television shows on Sunday night, and so they draw a lot of attention. So, and millions of citizens are deliberately exposed to campaign information that is pre-digested by political scientists and then, well, fed to voters. This is an example. It's not my research. It's Stefan Marshall who did it. And you see that in some countries, like in Belgium, 20% of the people participated. Kieskompas, 12% of all voters. So this is millions of people who, well, deliberately exposed themselves to campaign information that is structured via systems like a voting advice application. Austria is there, Germany, so the Wahlomat, 10% in 2009, this is the highest year of highest participation, right? 10% of the German voters exposed themselves to this kind of information. Second reason for worrying or caring about voting advice application is their content. This is just only about substantive policies. It's only about issue position. So I think it could go against a kind of trend to image politics, to leadership politics. It's just only about content. Some VAs include some leadership evaluation, but I think this is a bad idea. I think we should stick to the idea that it's about policy content. A third reason to think about VAs is that they probably go against it. They are non-partisan, so it's a kind of autonomous campaign player, and this is what I will elaborate a little. So, and there is some role of political scientists here in it. I think this is one of the ways in which we can do, in which we can be useful, in which we might be useful. So it's applied research, and some political scientists are even talking about a kind of quality label for VAAs, that this has the stamp of being a political scientific correct VEA compared to many other systems that are around. So it's a new autonomous campaign player. But does it affect the campaign? We don't really know. What is the effect of VEAs? There could be effects on voters. There could be effects on parties, there could be effects on campaign dynamics, and there could be effects on us, on what we are doing. And we could use the VEA data for scholarship. So we know a little about voters. We know hardly anything about the effects on campaigns. So the decreasing level of evidence and an increasing level of speculation. What are the effects on voters? There are three types of effects that have been found across European countries. It's on knowledge, it's on participation, and it's on the vote, on the actual vote. What about knowledge? I know of one study done by Schulze in Germany, and he finds some evidence that exposure to a VEA leads to more accurate placement of parties on policies. This makes sense. You fill in the system, and after a while, I think I checked it yesterday, Rudiger, after a while, a few weeks later, people still remember the position, or they're better able to place parties on the policies they've been confronted with. So this makes some sense. There is also some evidence on the turnout effect. Do VEAs lead people to the polls, people that would not have voted otherwise? Well, basically the idea is that a VEA spectacularly reduces the cost of getting informed. You don't have to read party manifestos. You don't have to go to the website of a political party. You don't have to listen to TV debates. You just go to a website, and in, I would say, in 5 minutes, if you're very fast, in 2 minutes, you can have a vote advice, or you have some information on where parties stand. And most studies find some cognitive effects, that people, when asking about their participation, they say they were seeking more information after being exposed to a VEA. But this is, of course, entirely a subjective measurement. We don't really know what this effect is. Some studies found turn effects from +3% to +20%. The thing is, the reliability of the data, it's about self-reporting, so this is a big thing. So much of the research is based on the participants themselves. So what you really need is national election studies, and you need questions about VEA participation in national election studies, and especially about what advice people got. This is especially for the next question about party votes. There are significant net effects found in Switzerland, in Germany, in the Netherlands. And so on the aggregate level, some people calculated that the presence of a vote advice application leads to 1% or 2% on the aggregate level increase in turnout. And Gemenis found that in the Netherlands, they even found a +4% aggregate turnout. The thing is, there is only a turnout effect when the first party on the list of parties is really very close. So if your first party on the list of parties you get in the rank order has only an overlap of 50%, people don't really feel compelled to go voting because they find out that their positions, there's a bad match between their positions and the best matching party in the party system. So only when the first party is close, people feel obliged or compelled to go voting. What about the party vote itself? Well, it's difficult to measure effects because there could be no effect. There could be a confirmation effect. They might instill doubt in the mind of the voter, or they might lead to changes of party preferences. And this, of course, is the strongest effect. So the subjective effect of VEAs, again, asking VEA users, varies between 6% and, in one study, 67% of participants declaring that they felt being shaken or being doubtful due to the participation in a vote advice application. There are panel data, so and there we see that people that in some countries, people who participate in a VEA have a larger tendency to switch during the campaign. So if you follow the same vote through the campaign and you distinguish the participants from the non-participants, against this might be a selection effect, an opt-in effect, but you see that those people who participate in the VEA are the ones who are more switching. Well, you find strong effects some people find strong effects in Switzerland and Finland. We in Belgium, we didn't find any effect of switching or increasing switching behavior. Other thing is that the effect is limited to within bloc switches. So you go from the Greens to the Socialists, or from it's switching between close parties. It's not a switch from, if you're extreme right voter and you get the advice to vote for the Green Party, this will have no effect on your vote. So it's when it's closed that you find out, okay, the party that I was already considering, it was my second or third party, this might lead to a change. And it is more effective the first and the second party are close. So if it's a close race, then the effect is larger, and of course mostly on undecided voters, which makes perfectly sense. And now the speculation starts. What is the vote advice application effect on parties? Well, the first thing is it might be that the party positions that are that have been concealed and that are being becoming visible through VEAs, I think they are more visible than the party manifesto. So there might be an effect that the VEA becomes the real party program, because millions of people participate and not millions of people read party manifestos. Nobody knows actually what is in the party manifestos. So it might be the case that in the future, responses of parties to VEA statements are replacing somehow or overruling what the parties are officially declaring in their party manifesto. And this would lead, I think, to a centralization of the party position. It's more about the leadership. While party manifestos might be carried by the whole party, the questionnaires are filled in by the party leadership only. So it might lead to a kind of, undercutting democracy within parties. I think it might also lead to an even more strategic positioning of parties, since they know this will be highly publicized. They care more about filling in the statements, filling in the questionnaire, than they care about their party manifesto. Another effect on parties might be that parties are forced to take positions on issues they did not have a position on. This is what we find in Belgium. Sometimes parties just don't know, they have no clue, and then suddenly because professors in political science says this is relevant, you should answer this statement, and journalists, and then parties said, oh, they are scrambling to find a position, they really don't have a clue. So this might be an effect on parties, that they are forced to take position. There are effects on the campaign as well. It might lead to delaying voting decisions. We don't really know. If the voters have a habit of filling it in, and if the system only comes in line 6 weeks or 4 weeks before the election, voters might just wait until the VEA is there to make up their mind. It might work against personalization. In most countries, except for the Swiss, in the Swiss case, it's individual candidates who are filling in the system, but in most countries it's about a party. So it might go against, it boosts party homogeneity, because candidates are expected to follow the party line, and the party line is the official answer of the party to those statements. Parties lose control, I think, I'm pretty sure of this, but we really need to study this further, on the campaign agenda. So policy statements are very, very precise, and most party manifestos are very vague. So it drags them to have very, very precise positions instead of hiding behind very vague principles. So it's more difficult for parties to talk next to each other. One of the big theories of the salience approach says that parties are talking next to each other. They each prefer to emphasize their favorable issues. Well, this goes right against it, because you force parties, or VEA builders force parties, to address all those issues. And it might be advantageous for relatively small new parties. It's always the case that small parties gain with those systems. They are mathematically, just since you have to give an advice, the chances that they come out on top or very high is large. They have an incomplete ideology, so they are free to fill in whatever they want, and it makes them relevant. So there are many cases in which small parties become relevant. So it might enhance fragmentation, it might enhance volatility of the vote. I think this might be the link with the crisis and the volatility, increasing de-alignment. It's the systems work this in the hand. And then there is the mediatization of the campaign, of course. What is the effect on campaign scholarship? I think these might be useful systems. The data are used to position parties in spatial models. There are several studies that use it instead of expert studies or instead of party manifestos. They use the statements to do a very similar thing, and it turns out that with 30 statements or 40 statements, you can pretty well and very well position parties, and it's very similar to what comes out from other systems. Basically, it's about policy issues, it's not about aggregate ideological dimensions. Second, some of us have been engaged a lot in so-called elite voter congruence. If you have official answers of parties on 30 statements or more statements in different elections, you can really study the issue, the party issue voter congruence on much more statements, and especially not on a general left-right dimension, which I don't trust, but much more on specific policy statements. So I think this might be useful. Some have used it for pledge fulfillment research. What are the promises party made? And Vivas showed in several countries that the pledge fulfillment rate is pretty high. So the things that party promise in those systems really turn out in reality. And then there is a possibility to observe the voter dynamics during the campaign, since those systems have massive daily measures of parties and of switches in position through the campaign. Conclusion, what is the future? Is this a boom or a bubble? Well, I think it's a boom. I would be out of business otherwise, but well, it's not. This is not the only business, but still. There is still no sign of weakening. In most countries, participation rates go up. Will the impact on the voter go up? Well, probably. As the volatility increases, as party identification decreases, I think the impact of those systems increases. The technology is more accessible, and voters get used to it. They trust. The other reasoning might be that they get bored, or that they distrust the system. So if the system becomes too partisan, I think there might be a kind of change in the evolution. Will the impact on parties' campaign increase? Most likely. I think parties are more and more trying to manipulate the system, to not to participate. So it's a big struggle of what the actual position of parties are. Are parties lying when they fill in the questionnaire? And some of us have experience with those eternal debates with parties. And I think in terms of research, I think it's relevant since millions of people use it. But we need especially data on the macro level. How does it affect parties? This is what we need. I think we know pretty well, well, not surely, but we know what it does with voters, but what it does with parties in the campaign and the media as well is still an open question. That's it. Thank you.